Today on Beerus TV investigates Catomorpha Stage 1 is a success. Hi, I'm Ryan, your host of Beerus TV Investigates, a weekly YouTube series which explores popular reefing theories, products, methods, what the manuals are missing, with a focus on putting them to the test. This week, we're concluding phase one of our Catomorpha test and sharing the evolution of this test with what phase two looks like. When we started this test, we were looking to identify, are Catomorpha-based refugiums effective as the primary source of nutrient reduction? Which means they're not only capable of removing nutrients, but acting as the primary method of maintaining low nitrate and phosphate without other significant sources of nutrient control. I'd wager a third of the community strongly believes that these types of refugiums are extremely effective at nitrate and phosphate control. Another third of reefers believing that they're going to reduce nutrients by half or a quarter, but not going to be the end-all solution. And the final third of reefers believing refugiums represent a pretty low value and not worth the time, effort, or space. End of the day, we just want to identify if there is value here, and if so, how much. If the fuge is removing half the nitrate and phosphate, it could mean half the water changes. If it's removing virtually all of them, it's the basis for being completely free of water changes with methods like Triton, which is founded upon the water changes not only being the most difficult way to maintain parameters in your reef tank, but water changes also do a less than stellar job at both nutrient export as well as maintaining elements. We shared some preliminary data on how the test was going a few weeks ago. We have now been running the test for 7 weeks and decided to end the test because the results seem to be consistent and compelling enough to share them and move on to stage two. Since we've shared most of this data a few weeks ago, I'm going to keep it relatively brief. Just as a reminder, we have 5 tanks. 4 of them started with 300 grams of Cato, various different light sources, and a control tank with no Cato. All fed a single cube of blended up mysis every day in an effort to identify if both Cato has the ability to remove a significant amount of the nutrients, as well as what impact different light sources have on the rate of photosynthesis and the related nitrate and phosphate intake. The light sources are indeed very different both in spectrum and intensity. We took some spectrum and PAR measurements, and I think they'll give you a window into the different performance of each light as we go on. Starting with PAR, we took a measurement 12 inches above the sensor in air, since the Cato often floats at the top and is exposed to air. The lowest PAR option was 26 PAR with the LED strip that comes with the hang-on CPR light. This light source is spread out a bit, so it might be underrepresenting the performance a bit, but in general, this is a fairly low PAR light source. Next was the compact fluorescent light with 85 PAR. Not super high, but considerably higher than the previous light source, and I'll let you know right now that you'll see it in the results. The PAR 38 screw-in LED was higher at 493 PAR, and the Kessel H380 was a pretty stunning 1581 PAR with the grow setting. This high PAR, again associated with an impact you'll almost certainly see in the results. One thing to note is PAR is just a measurement of photosynthetically active radiation, which spans a huge area of the total spectrum and includes some areas which are not as valuable to photosynthesis or chlorophyll. We often talk about PUR, which is photosynthetically usable radiation, and attempts to exclude some spectrums which are not as valuable to photosynthesis, chlorophyll, or plant growth. The green and yellow light are just significantly less valuable to the photosynthetic process. Look at the Kessel H380 in the grow spectrum setting, which is designed for plant growth. You can see it's very heavily focused on the important red and blue spectrums. However, when you look at the compact fluorescent bulb, there's a huge peak of light in the green range, so much of the light that this bulb is producing is of less value. You can see the LED strip that comes with the hang-on fuge has a ton of green and yellow and very little of the important red spectrum. And the PAR 38 bulb was pretty similar spectrum, but like 15 times the PAR as the hang-on strip. To give you an idea of how this all comes together, we took some measurements with the Senai as well, because the Senai measures PAR and basic PUR. It's not perfect because it's not a $3,000 spectrometer, but they do have 3 color spectrum sensors to give a general window into spectrum and PUR at a much lower price point. Again, starting with the Kessel H380 in growth mode, there are 2 things that you're looking at here. First is the black line over the colored spectrum chart. The black line represents the spectrum of your light and changes between light sources. The color spectrum chart behind it gives you an idea of the important spectrum ranges to chlorophyll and the photosynthetic process. You can see the green and yellow range here is represented as less important, and the blue and red peaks are the most important. The more light in the red and blue range, the better the photosynthetic properties of the light source. This is also represented by the per number in the upper right-hand corner, which states 88% per, which means 88% of the light is photosynthetically usable. In this case, the Senai seems to be over-reporting the green a bit, and why you see 88% per rather than a higher number? We know the real spectrum using our spectrometer, and it's likely closer to the upper 90% per. Looking at the fuller spectrum screw-in compact fluorescent bulb PER, you can see the black line is showing a significant amount of light in the less valuable green and yellow range, so the PER drops all the way down to 59%. The hang-on LED strip has similar properties in 59% PER as well. The PAR 38 LED is just a bit better at 66% PER. So when you're selecting a light for your fuse, there's no reason to care about the green and yellow spectrum because we don't care what it looks like visually. If you can and it makes economic sense, I would absolutely select a bulb that peaks in the red and blue spectrum range for a fuse, which generally speaking visually looks purple. Moving on to the testing parameters, we have a few other tests running in the background here, and one of the things that we've learned so far is phosphate levels have been much more stable and predictable in terms of both addition and reduction. So in some instances, monitoring phosphate gives a much better week-to-week pulse on how everything is going. Nitrate, on the other hand, was initially difficult to test for accurately. The results were fairly consistent, but the accuracy was less than desirable. In the end, we developed a reliable solution that we're going to use going forward. If you watched last week's episode when we tested all the different types and methods of testing nitrate, you already know the support team at Hawk helped us create a custom program for the DR3900, which uses the Red Sea 3 reagent process, which is specifically designed for testing nitrate in seawater, and then uses the DR3900 to accurately read the kit. This was ultimately the best solution of everything we tried by a significant margin. That process was essentially creating a seawater standard of 0, 1, 2, 4, 10, and 25 nitrate using Hawk NIST nitrate standard solutions, performing the Red Sea reagent method on all of them, and then reading the light absorbance of the various samples and entering those points as calibration points. We also scanned each standard test result to determine the best light wavelength to test with, which was ultimately 545. We tested those samples against new seawater points of 0, 1, 5, 10, 25, and 50, and the net result is we now have an accurate, consistent, and reliable method of testing nitrate, which is what we used on the last week of today's test. However, we also found that nitrate is less predictable and stable since nitrate is reliant on bacterial populations, much of which is fairly well-accepted theory but still contains some unknowns, particularly in the last stage where there's potential to transition into nitrogen gas as well as the impact of bacterial blooms or the impact the available organic carbon can have on the process. There's always going to be some challenges with fully understanding why and how nitrate rises and falls, but the data is consistent enough to give a reasonable window into what's happening here, especially when combined with how phosphate tracks with it. Let's start with the control. At the end of 7 weeks and a total of 35 cubes of mysis added to the tank, it has 2.46 parts per million phosphate. Looking at the week-over-week results with 5 cubes of food added a week, there was a pretty consistent increase of 0.4 to 0.5 parts per million each week. Meaning, I think in a tank this size, it might be fair to expect phosphate increases in the neighborhood of 0.1 parts per million per day with 1 cube of mysis. With nitrate, the control ended up at just shy of 50 parts per million using the new Red Sea reagent and Hawk method. As I mentioned earlier, we weren't very impressed with the accuracy of the readily available testing methods out there prior to this change. So with today's results, we're just going to focus on the N nitrate, which we're confident is represented accurately. So end of the day, the goal of all the other test tanks is just be lower than 2.46 parts per million phosphate and 50 parts per million nitrate. Let's start with the hang-on fuse, which most people say has a pretty limited value or even a waste of time. After 7 weeks and 35 cubes of food, we ended with a phosphate level of 0.75 parts per million and a nitrate level of 6.6, which is about a 70% decrease in phosphate and an 86% decrease in nitrate. Well, not 100% effective, I'd call this pretty impressive results. Once you factor in consumption by the livestock in the tank, the levels would likely be pretty darn low. I would like to point out a few elements with the hang-on's performance. I do still think there's some mystery here that hasn't been completely solved. One is related to the nutrient density of the cato or chlorophyll it contains. One of the things that we noticed was the lower PAR per options tended to result in a much darker cato, which may mean that the light is producing a denser population or type of chlorophyll and related density of nutrients than the higher PAR per light sources. The vegetative growth was also significantly slower, and by weight, there was a very small increase in mass. In this case, the hang-on fuge went from 300 grams to just 334 grams in 7 weeks. You'll also notice that from week 1 to 4, the Cato had no issue keeping the phosphate below 0.1, and then suddenly it shot up to 0.77. It's very possible we simply reached a maximum nutrient density for this small amount of Cato, and the 26 par light strip with low PER just isn't producing enough energy to support rapid vegetative or mass growth. I strongly believe that the small amount of mass growth has little to do with the fact that this is a hang-on fuge or even its size. Simply that the light strip is a convenient, low-profile, and affordable option, but pretty far from the best option for providing photosynthetic energy, which is going to support rapid growth and nutrient reduction. Next up is the compact fluorescent bulb and a clip-on reflector. This is easily the most common fuge lighting option out there. Tons of reefers have used it successfully, and the entire solution costs around 10 bucks. And you can see why it's so popular, because after 7 weeks, this tank had zero nitrate, zero phosphate, and pretty darn effective. The growth by weight was slightly more as well, and grew from 300 grams to 445. I would say it was much slower growing by mass than the other higher PER or PAR options. And the only other note I would say is this test tank consistently had a general cloudy haze in the water itself, so it was likely not outcompeting every organism in the tank for nutrients. Similar to that, the screw-in LED bulb with the 493 PAR also ended the 7 weeks with zero phosphate and zero nitrate, but the LG mass itself grew from 300 grams to 683 grams, which is considerably more impressive. I'd also note that this tank ebbed and flowed as far as clarity was concerned, but it was significantly clearer than the compact fluorescent bulb. Lastly, I don't think any of you will be surprised to see that the 1581 PAR Kessel H380 also ended with zero phosphate and zero nitrate, and the LG mass itself almost quadrupled from 300 grams to 1169. In this case, the water was almost always crystal clear, and I will say the LG mass itself was much lighter green and physically less dense than the others. I'd almost call it fluffy. There's no question the increased PAR and PER produced increased photosynthetic rates, which had three benefits. Kept the nutrients more consistently low throughout the entire test. The water was much clearer, indicating it was outcompeting other undesirable elements the other light sources struggled with. And while the rest of the tanks were generally in the 8 to 8.2 pH range, the rapid photosynthesis and consumption of carbon dioxide from the tank was producing consistent pHs above 9 by the end of the test. A pH of 9 is a pretty incredible number, and it wouldn't be that in a larger tank with more gas exchange, but for those of you that are looking to use a fuge to maintain higher pHs at night or reduce the overall daily pH swings most reef tanks have, increasing the PAR and PER of your lights will almost certainly produce those desirable results. So net result here is three of our tanks were able to completely avoid all of the 2.46 parts per million phosphate and almost 50 parts per million nitrate. I also strongly believe the hang-on would have achieved similar results with a higher performance light source. However, what we haven't proven is this will have the same impact on an actual reef tank. All we've really proven is a giant ball of Cato in a small cube has the ability to uptake all the nutrients from a daily addition from a single cube of mysis. However, this is an intentional progression. More or less, a real reef tank has thousands of different variables, different equipment and export methods, and performing this type of test in a live reef tank as step one would have been pretty low value, because there'd be no way of knowing what the actual cause of the low nutrients was. That's why we started out by stripping out all the variables down to a simple glass box with Cato in it and a controlled amount of nutrients. The first goal was to simply identify to a reasonable degree if Cato is even capable of a significant amount of nutrient reduction in the simplest of environments. I think we demonstrated that fairly convincingly, so it's time to evolve our test to something closer to a real-world environment. So we're indeed going to evolve this test onto phase two, and while I'm not ready to incorporate corals in a full-on reef tank, we're going to get this much closer to a reef tank setup in our next test using the Vertex AB tanks. In this setup, we're going to add common biological filtration with 1 year cycled live rock, actual livestock with fish, more normal nutrient source, still using mysis but not blended, and a competing light source which operates on opposite hours from the fuge, meaning we're going to light the tank. In this case, we decided to maintain a control tank with no fuge, a fuge lit with the compact fluorescent bulb, a fuge with the Kessel H380, as well as a newer H80, which is smaller. Just for reference, the H80 is only 15 watts, where the larger 380 is 90 watts, so it's going to be significantly lower PAR. In growth mode, it came in at 95 PAR and 87% PER. However, looking at the Spectrum, which is almost completely in the red and blue range, I wouldn't be surprised if the real PER percentage was a bit higher than that. The H80 likely produces about 50% more usable light than the much lower cost compact fluorescent, and at $130 has a different type of value proposition. The Spectrum mix might produce better results, but I think a lot of the value here is in the cool factor that a compact fluorescent just doesn't have. However, I think most people in this price range will likely jump to the H380, which has a much more impactful difference. In this test, we're going to continue monitoring nitrate and phosphate against the control each week. However, in this case, we're also going to look for a different type of real-world result, which is, can the light outcompete the light in the tank for nutrients and prevent algae growth in the tank? We've mentioned a few times that it's wise to consider the amount of light in the display tank and how you're going to light the fuge to outcompete it for nutrients. So we decided to add some balance to that equation, and we're using a Kessel A360 for the reef tank lights in the display, and we use the spectral controller to create a common 10-hour 0 to 100% ramp or photo period. We plan on running the test for 3 months. The first month, one cube of mysis a day with no lights in the front of the tank to get a general idea how the fuges perform in a real tank. Then we'll turn the lights on in the display and one cube a day for a month, then up the game and test two cubes of mysis a day for 1 month. I think this test is going to be much closer to a real-world environment and give us all an idea exactly how effective these different fuges perform at nutrient control, but even more importantly, how they perform against a competing light source in the display. We all obviously hope that they can outcompete the display for nutrients and prevent undesirable algae growth in the tank. In conjunction with that, we're also going to use the Apex to control a stable temp and record the pH swings. I know a lot of reefers use refugiums to naturally and consistently increase their overall night pH in hopes of increased stability and higher calcification and coral growth rates associated with those higher pHs close to 8.3. I think it'll be interesting to see the various impacts and help to quantify the value of each individual light source. My expectation is we're going to end up seeing the control tank with no fuge completely overrun with algae at some point. The net nitrate and phosphate levels will just be in a range where that's a strong likelihood. So it'll be really interesting to see which of the three fuges can prevent that. The feedback and conversation on the first update on this test was super awesome over on Reef to Reef, so I can't wait to see what everyone thinks about today's results, how they apply to your own experiences and your reef tanks. I'm also pretty excited to hear what everyone thinks about phase two, and if you're excited as we are to see the results, so check out our link below to the Reef to Reef thread to see what everyone is saying. As always, if you think what we're doing here has value and all the time and resources we throw at it is something that you want to see more of, let us know with a quick thumbs up and subscribe, because we release multiple reefing videos every week. See you next week with another BRS TV Investigates.